Welcome to our Sunday morning adult Bible study. We are looking at the Overcomer Bible study based on the Overcomer movie viewed at Christ the King several weeks ago. We have looked at previous lessons, and today will be the last study we have on this particular lesson, this study. Let us begin in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for this time, and we once again look to you. We look to you to provide for us the spiritual food, the spiritual nourishment that we need as we open your word today. Thank you that Jesus is the bread of life, and that he promises that as we come to him, we will never hunger. As we believe in him, we will never thirst. So we come to you now, praying that you will satisfy our spiritual need as we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. In the first four studies, we have considered the following themes. Who am I? We looked at the life of Moses, who actually asked that question in a conversation with God. We discovered in Moses' life that he spent the first 40 years of his life thinking he was a somebody, then spending 40 years of his life discovering that he really was a nobody, a key experience for him in coming to understand his identity and the answer to the question, who am I? Then he spent the final 40 years of his life discovering what God can do with a nobody. Then we looked at the theme, I am broken. The bottom line is that every one of us are broken, but we really need to come to realize that before we can have a proper sense of our identity. Then we considered the theme, I am chosen. Perhaps you can recall, as I did and as I related when I was a youngster in elementary school. In the springtime, it was time for recess, and we always loved to play softball. Now, as a first grader and in the lower grades, I had to wait and wait and wait, as did most of the students, to be chosen for a team. While the upper grades in elementary school, those players were chosen first, especially those very skilled and very good at softball. But you know, God doesn't choose us on the basis of such things. In God's eyes, every one of us is the smallest, the slowest, the most uncoordinated, the most inept when it comes to playing softball, as it were. But he chooses us first. Now, it doesn't seem right to say he chooses every one of us first, because if everyone is first, no one is first. I'm just using that statement as to understand the concept that we are chosen by God, not because of skill or eloquence or anything, but because he is a God who loves us, who created us in his image and wants to redeem us from sin. And then last week we looked at the theme, I surrender. We have to surrender everything we have and are into the hands of God and let him make us into that person that he has created us to be and he has saved us to be in order to truly have a proper identity, proper answer to the question, who am I? Today we want to look at just another video clip as we today consider the theme, You Declare.
Welcome back to the Overcomer Movie Bible Study. Each week we've been watching clips from the movie Overcomer, and then we've been diving into what God's Word says about the important issue of identity. This is one of my favorite clips we're about to see in the movie, and it is talking about what does it mean to be in Christ, and then how do we declare that to others.
In this scene, 15-year-old Hannah Scott is finally beginning to understand who she is in Christ, that she has precious worth and that she's loved, forgiven, and chosen, and she cannot wait to share.
While we're compiling our notes, the rest of you can get your things together. The bell should ring in about 3 minutes.
No.
Hannah, you okay?
Ask me who I am. Ask me who I am.
Who is Hannah Scott?
I am created by God. He designed me. So I'm not a mistake. His son died for me. Just so I could be forgiven. He picked me to be his own. So I'm chosen. He redeemed me. So I am wanted. He showed me grace. Just so I could be saved. He has a future for me. Because he loves me. So I don't wonder anymore, Coach Harrison. I am a child of God. I just wanted you to know.
Did you see that? That's what I'm talking about. That was fire! John, why is she not in my class?
Hannah. What happened to you?
I talked to Miss Brooks yesterday. And prayed. And then I read in Ephesians.
Yeah.
And it was like God was talking directly to me.
This is amazing. What you said in there was amazing.
I want to know more. I want to read more.
You can. I want Amy to hear this. Can we go see her? What's your next class?
English.
Today, as we consider our identity in Christ, especially the theme you declare, we'd like to look at a glimpse of the Apostle Paul as recorded in Philippians chapter 3. We saw how Hannah Scott came to realize her true sense of identity through becoming a child of God, through faith in Jesus Christ. This is basically what Paul is relating to us in Philippians 3. And as we see before us on the screen, verse 3 of Philippians 3, Paul says we, he's referring here to true Christians. He's writing to Christians in the city, a place of Philippi, the Philippian church. And so he says, we are the true circumcision, as contrasted to those who were just physically circumcised according to the law. Who worship in the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. Paul is really sharing a testimony here of the transformed life that took place for him when he came to saving faith in Jesus Christ. Put no confidence in the flesh, he says. He goes on to say, although I myself might have confidence even in the flesh. And so in the next verses, Paul goes on to describe why, from the Jewish perspective, the legalist perspective, the works righteousness perspective, he would have confidence in the flesh. But notice, again, his testimony is such that he puts no confidence in the flesh. Paul is not doing that. He's just saying, if he were going to, he'd have great reason to do so. He introduces himself according to his current beliefs before he goes on to speak of his former beliefs. What were those former beliefs? If anyone else has a mind but confidence in the flesh, he says, I far more. Circumcised on the eighth day. That was according to the command of the Old Testament. The command God gave to Abraham when he introduced the covenant of circumcision. He says he was of the people, the nation of Israel, God's chosen people. He was among them. Of the tribe of Benjamin. The tribe of Benjamin was a very privileged tribe that often served in the aristocracy. They were a high social class. They served in the government. So that was a very status type thing for the Jewish people. A Hebrew of Hebrews. He means that Paul had not lost his Hebrew culture as it had come from the Old Testament. He was a Pharisee. To be a Pharisee meant to be a separated one. The Pharisees were very well respected people. Every man would want his daughter to marry a Pharisee if possible. But the Pharisees added traditions to the Word of God and practically started to replace the Word of God. So while they were highly esteemed, they were strained from God's will, strained from God's truth. And they saw that their strict obedience to the law, both of God and their own invented laws, was the way they found favor with God. Paul writes that he was zealous for God, as to zeal a persecutor of the church. He wasn't just a religious man. He was very zealous about his faith. He was zealous to show a supposed love for God by doing God's will, even the invented will of God that the Pharisees created, but zeal also in hating what God hates. In his misguided life, in the misinformation Paul lived by, he was so zealous for God that he persecuted and killed Christians, followers of Jesus Christ. As to zeal, he says, a persecutor of the church. Finally, as to the righteousness which is in the law, found blameless. In other words, he meticulously obeyed every letter of the law. You see, all these things was what Paul once declared in terms of what made him a good follower of God, a good believer. And that's where his identity was rooted in. Remember last week how Coach John Harrison was asked the question by the man in the hospital bed, who he was. And it was quite a ways down the list before he mentioned he was a Christian. Those things important to him in his life identified him, gave him his identity. And the same was true here of the Apostle Paul. He basically found his identity in his good works, the things that he was confident pleased God. What had Paul's previous, and note these were past tense mentions, things mentioned, rooted in? We have discussed them briefly, and we could say much more about them. But to a strict Jew of the New Testament time, Paul was pretty impressive person. Pause the video briefly now to discuss and consider how a focus on my achievements affects my answer to the identity question, who am I? Perhaps you're watching this together as a couple, or maybe you've teamed up with someone else to do this on Zoom or over the phone, but take a few moments now to pause and to discuss. Welcome back. We'll continue by turning to verse 7 of Philippians chapter 3, where Paul says, whatever things were gained to me, those things I have counted as loss for the sake of Christ. What is he, in effect, saying here? He's saying that those things that were positives in his life, that gave him standing before God, at least he believed that. It didn't give him a standing, but he believed that. all those things that, as I mentioned earlier, were such tremendous credentials in the eyes of the Jewish population. And again, they believed it was tremendous credentials before God, but they were not. All these things, Paul says, I'm giving up. I've counted them as not gain, but loss. Not credits to my account before God, but loss, debits. And really, that's exactly what they were. Why did he do that? It says, for the sake of Christ. For the sake of Christ. Everything he did before was for his sake. It was a very self-focused, self-centered means of achieving rightness with God. And of course, as was mentioned, this affects his identity, his answer to the question, who am I? So the question then is, how important is it for me to do the same thing? How important for me to do the same thing? Keep these thoughts in mind as we progress here. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 8 and 9, consider what was Paul releasing in his life, counting as nothing. And really, worse than nothing, because the word in verse 8 is literally dung, manure. More than that, I count all things to be lost in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. The surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, had replaced the surpassing value of all the good things Paul did, of all the good things he sought so hard to become and to be. There was this replacement taking place, the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them but rubbish so that I may gain Christ. Notice Paul here says, count them but rubbish. That's the word in the original language, is literally dung, manure. He was releasing all of his former achievements as a good Jew, a good Hebrew, a good Pharisee, in place of simply knowing Jesus Christ, having a faith in him, so that I might gain Christ, he says. What does it mean to gain Christ? To gain Christ, we make him our priority. It's not a matter of making our efforts our priority. Our effort to please God our priority. Our effort to be a good Christian, as Paul sought to be a good Jew. No, Jesus is the priority that we seek. A person, not a status, not a social standing or anything like that. We seek a person, the Son of God, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Secondly, to gain Christ means to have faith in him. We trust in him as our Savior, to believe that what he did on the Calvary's cross is all I need for my salvation. I don't need to add anything to it. I don't need to perform good works or anything like that. It means that when I fail, I don't try to do something to make up for that. I turn again to the cross, standing steadfastly at the foot of the cross. Nothing in my hand I bring, as the hymn writer says, simply to thy cross I cling. To gain Christ, we must continually cultivate our desire for him. I'm sure there were times when Paul desired to be even better in terms of being a good Jew, a good Pharisee, and so on. But Jesus Christ is a person. He is our personal Savior. We have a personal relationship with him. And to gain him, we must press on in that desire to know him more and more. And we must continually experience that relationship with him, not just say we have it, but experience it. Imagine a husband and wife getting married, and after the wedding, they go off and do their own thing. They don't spend any time together. They rarely communicate with one another. That would not be much of a relationship. That husband would really not have gained a wife, and the wife would not have gained a husband. As we seek to gain Christ, we continue to cultivate our experience with him. Paul then goes on to describe further what he means here. And may be found in him, a faith relationship, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law. That's what Paul had before. He fabricated his own righteousness by what he did and what he sought to become. Not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith. Previously, he wanted the righteousness that came from his efforts. Righteousness which came from his efforts. Now he wants, longs for, and pursues the righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith. So we can ask the question here, what was the specific reason Paul was counting all these things as loss? Why did he throw them out the window, throw them away as rubbish, or, as I mentioned, as dung or manure, in order that he could gain Christ, to be found in him, to have a righteousness that came to him based upon that particular faith? And so we want to just move ahead here and ask the question, how can we compare the righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith with Paul's fabricated righteousness? And we've been doing that a little bit already, but to go back and to review. First of all, verse 9. Paul wanted to be found in him, not having that righteousness of his own derived from the law, but that which comes through, simply through faith in Christ. The righteousness which God gives to us as a gift on the basis of our faith in our risen Savior. How do we compare? The righteousness which comes from God is a gift to us. It's not something we can produce. It's not something that we have from within us. It's something that comes from outside of us, comes from God on the basis of faith. It's a gift to us. It's the very righteousness of Jesus himself. And I'll go back to verse 5 and 6 here and consider Paul's previous, as we have there, fabricated righteousness. All these things are not gifts from God. They are things that Paul saw as his achievements based upon his righteousness. Things that Paul produced for himself. Now think back to Moses' answer to the question, who am I? The first 40 years of his life, he thought he was somebody because he was raised in the Pharaoh's household. He was literally a prince. He was literally royalty in the great land of Egypt. He was not thinking of something that God gave him, although we might say God orchestrated the events that brought him to that place, but he was looking at himself, as it were, in a mirror, just as Paul used to do, and saw all these lists of things before us, and thought he was really somebody. It was a fabricated righteousness, which was a stench in God's eyes. It was horrible. It was worthless as far as God was concerned. But that's what Paul was basing his sense of identity upon. And so as we think of them, and our fabricated righteousness is not identical to Paul's by any means, but how would these two forms of righteousness affect our identity? It would affect our identity because one is rooted in me, the other is rooted in God. The other finds its basis in me, the other finds its basis in God. Who am I? Literally, I am a fallen, sinful creature. the identity that I can produce or have or find in myself is one of fallenness, sinfulness, not just in the eyes of God, but in truth and in reality. The righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith, the gift he gives to me, gives me an identity where I fully appreciate and understand having been created in God's image and having been redeemed by a loving Savior. At this time, pause the video briefly to again discuss further the above question. Welcome back. We move on now as we turn to chapter 3 in Philippians, verse 10, where Paul continues by saying that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, be conformed to his death, in order that I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Notice several things that Paul says here. In terms of his desire to know Christ, to know him as Savior in his life, to know him and the power of his resurrection. The question can be asked, how can a Christian not have power in his life? Through a relationship with the Savior who was declared with power to be the Son of God through his resurrection from the dead. We have that relationship with him. We have his Spirit living within us. Paul longed to experience that in his daily lives, not the power of his efforts previously exerted, but the power of Christ within. But Paul also desired to know Christ through sharing in his sufferings. To follow Christ in this world means to suffer just like he did. Paul taught that suffering for Christ is a tremendous grace that each true believer has received in some measure or another. I think of the disciples in the book of Acts who said they rejoiced because they were considered worthy to suffer for Jesus' name. All over the world today, believers are participating in the fellowship of Jesus' sufferings. Some to a much, much greater degree than others. I often think that we are, as Christians, kind of spoilt in the United States of America. Having grown up in a country and a culture that was pretty much positively looked upon Christianity, respected it. Now, we know that that has changed drastically in the last several years. Last decade or so, a couple decades maybe, and it continues to change drastically. But Paul here wanted to know not just the power of Jesus' resurrection, but the fellowship of his sufferings. Like the disciples in Acts, he considered a privilege, a reason to rejoice. And really, when you understand that the world hates Jesus Christ, We should want to be so identified with him that we recognize and experience that in our lives to a certain degree. Paul desired also to know Christ through dying like him, conformed to his death. And really, that's what faith does for us. It unites us with the death of Christ. I've been crucified with Christ, Paul says. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. In Romans 6, Paul says, we have been buried, therefore, through baptism into death. We've been buried with Christ through our baptisms into him, but also risen with him. And then Paul goes on to say, through know Christ, through experiencing his resurrection. You know, at this point in our lives, we all have experienced that spiritually. We've been raised to new life. We've been given new life in our Lord Jesus Christ, and we should live out that new life each day in our lives. But there is yet another resurrection coming too, isn't there? Paul's talking about that here, that one day, like Jesus, he would rise from the dead and live together with his Lord forever and ever in all of eternity. How does Paul identify in Jesus, how Paul's identity in Jesus rests fully in Christ and what Christ alone had accomplished? We've mentioned numerous times how Paul's identity was previously in all that he had accomplished. I think that was true as we looked at the video of last week's lesson, where the coach John Harrison focused on his accomplishments in order to establish his sense of identity. Paul had done that, but now he has made a switch, a conversion. His identity rests fully in Jesus Christ and what Jesus Christ had accomplished for him, Jesus and him alone. Once again, pause the video to discuss this question in light of Paul's example. Welcome back. We'll move on then to verse 12. And we consider in these next verses, the last portion we'll look at in Philippians 3, Jesus' purpose for the believer's life. The Apostle Paul expresses that purpose in the first person. He expresses how he is seeking that purpose in his life. Not that I've already obtained it. He is saying, not that I've already obtained the resurrection from the dead, or have already become perfect. In other words, a perfect Christian. He used to think he was a perfect Israelite, a perfect Pharisee, and so on. But he realizes that in his Christian life, the perfection comes from Jesus Christ. However, even though our perfection comes as a gift from God, having given us the righteousness of Christ, and that is where we find our identity. Notice we have a purpose. Paul says, I press on so that I may lay hold of that for which also I was laid hold of by Christ Jesus. The movie Overcomer is about a cross-country race. Several races depicted, a cross-country runner, Hannah Scott. But in the final race of that movie, where Hannah wins the race, we notice how, by way of a recording, her father was helping her to press on. And while the Christian life is not based upon works at all, not based upon our abilities or our efforts, there are disciplines that are very important for us to recognize. And that is the pressing on to lay hold of that for which also we have been laid hold of by Christ Jesus. When he died on the cross and rose from the grave, he was basically saying to Satan, I take back what you have captured in the Garden of Eden. I have reclaimed my possession. He laid hold of us, not just to save us from the horrors of hell and the grip of Satan. He laid hold of us to make us his beloved children, living for him each day of our lives. In spite of the struggle, because of the sin nature which remains, it's our passion to press on, to lay hold of that which Jesus Christ has laid hold of us for. Paul reiterates it, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet, but one thing to do, I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead. You know, there should have been a lot of guilt in Paul for all that persecution that he did, thinking he was serving God. He repented of that, I'm sure, but he wasn't going to let it hold him back. He wasn't going to let it plague his life. He was not going to let his sins and his shortcomings hold him back, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. That is the Christian's desire, that upward call. Again, while we do not earn it in any way, shape, or form by our efforts, we realize that there is, as Paul is indicating here, in kind of athletic language, that striving for that blessed eternal life which God has provided for us through his Son. Let us therefore, as many as are perfect, we are perfect in Christ, possessing his righteousness. Let us therefore, as many as are perfect, have this same attitude, Paul is saying, pressing on toward the goal for the prize of God in Christ Jesus, moving forward, leaning forward into the blessed life that God has provided. And as we do that, we live our lives here on earth like we are residents of heaven already. We will stumble and fall. We will make mistakes. We will sin. But God has provided for us to come back to the foot of the cross and receive cleansing. Our identity is not affected by our sin in the present or our sin in the past because of the absolute confidence we have in Jesus Christ and his forgiveness. Paul says, if in anything you have a different attitude, God will reveal that also to you. However, let us keep living by that same standard to which we have attained. That's the purpose God has redeemed us for. Again, not for us to establish our own sense of identity, but to rest in the identity we have in God through Jesus Christ. The identity that comes from being created by a loving God in his image, redeemed by a loving Savior who gave his life for us. And Paul is indicating in these last verses on the screen here about a difference of attitudes. God will govern and guide each of us in terms of our own walk with him, our own pressing on toward that goal. In other words, we don't make rules for somebody else. We don't compare ourselves with someone else. I think that's what Paul is especially trying to do here. If you have a different attitude, I'm not going to judge you for it, and don't you judge me for that. Live according to the standard which God sets before you. Now, obviously, he's not going to set a standard before someone, you shall not commit adultery, and a standard before another person, another Christian, it's okay if you do. That's not what he's talking about here. He's not talking about God's rules and standards that are established in his word. He's talking about our individual relationship with Jesus Christ and how we may press on toward that goal for the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. How does realizing God's purpose for me affect the question of who am I? Again, it's all centered in what God has done for me in Christ Jesus. And my longing to move further and further into that righteous relationship established through Christ on the cross, given to me as a gift by God through faith in him. It's not, again, something that I achieve for myself, but something God gives to me. And that affects the way then that I live, the way that I press on to know him more, the way that I press on to achieve that prize, that heavenly salvation, which God has for us. And so, one last time, pause the video to discuss further the above question. Welcome back. In this passage of Philippians 3, we have seen Paul declare his identity in Christ. That's the theme before us today, you declare. And as Hannah Scott in that brief video clip stood there and before all those students declared who she was in Jesus Christ and the blessings and benefits of that, forgiveness of sin, being chosen by God, knowing who I am in Christ and so forth. We've seen Paul declare his identity in Christ in these verses of Scripture, and even though our study is over, I would encourage you to go back and read and reread them again, meditate upon them sometime. Just as Hannah declared her identity in the video, in another portion of the movie, Hannah was challenged to read Ephesians 1 and 2 and write down everything she was as a result of Jesus' saving work. In this final study, this would be an excellent exercise for us to do as well. We close this series of studies as we close this study now, and we do so in a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we give you thanks today for the way we can answer the question, who am I? I pray, Lord, that none of us will be tempted to look within or to look at our performance, to answer the question based on who am I in myself, but who am I in Christ Jesus? Thank you, Father, for creating us in your image as individually loved children by you. You love each one of us individually. And Lord, you have provided redemption for us through Jesus Christ in spite of the fact that we have strayed from you in sin. And so, Lord, we pray that the result of these studies and this study today will be that we live with that identity ever before us, our identity in Christ. And we would declare to the world around us how they too can experience that through a relationship with Jesus, our Savior. And so we pray once again that you'll bless your truth to our hearts as we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.